Tim, as an animator watching this, was there anything just on a technical level about the animation that jumped out at you as particularly magnificent?
I mean, when we talked about the effects, it's the effects, the animated effects. There was a department at Disney which was the animated effects department, and I wish I could remember the name of the artist, but I believe like the head artist in that department was an Asian American, Chinese American, I think, animator, and he was kind of one of the first. I'm forgetting the name right now, but. Like the parts with the snowflakes at the end of the Nutcracker suite, the rotating snowflakes, like looks like CG to me. It's like a perfect fidelity with 3D with like really well achieved like glossiness on it. And when they're spinning past camera, it's like, wow, this is. And then there are parts in the Toccata and Fugue section where you see the bridge of a violin or viola or something like rotate past camera again, like really beautifully done in 3D. I mean, these things are done with some kind of live action reference. They did the same thing with Cruella DeVille's car in 101 Dalmatians. You may, in your mind's eye, remember like how 3D that car feels, and it's because they built it in cardboard and filmed it in different angles, and then the artists were able to trace over it. And I think the point is not that that's cheating, but the point is that these artists were trying lots of things other than just drawing pictures to achieve like unique, specific animated effects.
And then there's the fish doing like the
The fish,
synchronized dancing. That sequence is amazing, dude. I think it's so cool when we go underwater and like the camera is moving through these sort of different like there's like real depth of field as you're moving through the water and fish are swimming up and they're noticing the camera and like getting spooked and going away. And so it's like super engrossing and mysterious, and there's even this cool like ripple effect that happens over the screen. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Well, you're getting to one of the things that I was so impressed with on this watch, which is just this movie is like an incredible showcase of the like state-of-the-art special effects that Disney was doing at the time, because there is so there's the multi-plane camera, which is like a 20 feet tall down shooter rig where they've just got layers of glass. And each layer of glass has a different painting on it. As the camera moves towards them and through them or across them, that's how you achieve the parallax of moving planes. You know, nowadays we would just do it with a computer composite and you would have those virtually set into virtual space. But back in the day, they had to physically do
It's
it.
amazing.
And if you go to the Disney Family Museum in the Bay Area, they have a down shooter, they have the multiplane camera
Is that also
on
how they
view.
get that water ripple effect? Are they actually using shooting through water, like to
So I have a book that I will read someday that I think will explain how they did that. No, I don't think they would shoot through water because water would be impossible to control frame by frame, and the down shooter shoots one frame at a time. But what I think they probably have is that some of the layers are basically like ground glass that has a certain distortion to it. Essentially, you're like moving like a lens across a layer. That's how I think they
Yeah,
do
it's
it.
just
But there are other
when
moments.
the fish like swim
I was
away,
just gonna
like their tail leaves like a ripple in the lens, like in the frame. Maybe they're actually manipulating some sort of plastic.
Another good example is with the fairies. The fairies kind of leave jet streams behind
It's
them,
amazing.
and then they also
Amazing.
have fairy they have fairy dust that they are using from their like magic wands. But those are two different textures, and you don't notice it consciously. But there is a the trails that the fairies leave behind them basically stick to the path that the fairy followed. But fairy dust in all Disney movies, fairy dust has some like fallout. Fairy dust is like subject to gravity, and so they'll go ding, and there will be like a little firework explosion, but then it will have this little trail of sparkling snow or something that falls from it. And those textures are totally abstract. Like, we don't know what they are. They do become tactile somehow, but they have to be designed. And it's interesting because it goes beyond just graphic design. It's a motion design too. And there are parts like, how do you animate a sparkle? Later on in the 80s, they would develop this technology where you would actually cut. So you would let's say you have a character with a flashlight who shines a flashlight sort of at camera, and you want to get that glow. So in the 80s, they figured out a way to do double exposure such that you would do all that, and then you would have another layer, another pass, which was the lighting pass, where you would have like a black card, and you'd cut out a circle out of the black card, and then shine a light through it, and then slightly defocus the camera so that you would get that glow. And you but then you would have to animate the kind of the glow following that all around. So the point is that that lighting effect was like very hard to achieve in the 80s. In the 40s, they didn't have that. And so how are you going to achieve the effect of a sparkling light when all you have is paint? And in that sense, like it's a total triumph of an animation design. The sparkles, if you look at it, and there are lots of different solutions, but one of the ways they do it is if a sparkle like grows and shrinks, they'll start with an X. And then they'll add another axis, then it's like a six-sided star, and then it'll go to an eight-sided star, and then it'll animate back down.
I
So
see.
you have this like this kind of like blinking thing, and it feels like it's sparkling because there's this like kind of random chatter in the interaction of these spokes, if that makes sense. So there are like all sorts of really amazing technical achievements in this movie, and not a single one of these vignettes like does not feature one of those, except for Dance of the Hours, which is another thing that makes Dance of the Hours kind of lame. But everything else, you know, there's flowing wine, there's lightning bolts, there's lighting effects on Chernabog. I mean, like he's underlit for most of it, and the whole thing looks like an animated painting. It doesn't look like animation cell paintings. Like it's like there's like a there are no outlines on Chernabog. Maybe that's a way to say it. It's like a form with light hitting the form, and all of that stuff. When you think about what it takes to achieve technically, is mind blowing.